once I had a little girl. Sometimes I think about her, but you know she's not really there. Memories come, I just can't live without her. I try
And now we'd like to do a couple songs off our new album for you. And we're gonna keep it Shannon Owen in here.
Thank you.
Right now, we'd like to ask some friends of ours from Wet Willie to come out and join us. Come on, where are you? Here they go. And we want everybody to join us as we cook up some steam and get on board for the locomotion. All right.
When I grow up, maybe I want to be a mechanic. I want to be a rock and roll drummer.
I range anywhere from a decadent punk to a decrepit old man. I'm ready for anything. It wouldn't really shock me if my head all of a sudden said, well, I'm going to be a dock worker in Holland. I'd probably just up and do it.
Mark's like an Indian. He digs outdoors.
Mark's the guy I grew up with.
Mark's the guy you stole from that band.
I got you in our group.
Yeah, I remember that.
Last week, a buddy of mine caught a 26-inch pike out of here, right up here by the mill pond.
I ain't had much time for fishing this year.
You ready to ride, bud, sir?
To your town, we'll help you party down. We're an American. a guy that takes two shots if you don't catch him. He does it sly.
You know, it's dark, mysterious.
Uh-oh.
It's a bass player. He reverberates with his speakers.
Feels it. Feels what he's playing.
Yeah, it's like sex. You gotta feel it.
No, the black varmint.
Craig is a depressive humorist.
Somebody tell me, Mark, who am I?
You crazy Craig.
You can trust me. You got insurance, you can trust me with it. I wouldn't be a speed freak with it. I wouldn't.
It's got it.
It's the only thing I've got.
I don't know. You can't apply yet.
Oh, thanks.
Cut. My seatbelt's in the door.
Cut. Hang on.
we're going to take a step back and we're going to dedicate this song to everybody. Everybody in this little place doing their thing. Time doing the best I can. Balls and bars, they say on me, but I don't want no sympathy. just to watch him to see him. We'll be right back.
They were three working-class rockers from a hard-luck factory town whose muscular rock and roll soul powered its way up the charts.
Being a rock star and having the fame and having all this glory, it was hard to get a hat to fit.
We were selling millions and millions of records. Success was really being sweet.
Our career took off faster than we could hang on to it, basically.
These were three guys that did not have a choreographer. Or an image consultant.
The things they sang about fit an image that people already had of the band. You know, it's this traveling rock and roll outfit.
It was arena rock at its biggest.
Grand Funk Railroad was a hit-making juggernaut until they were derailed by million-dollar lawsuits and devastating tax problems.
All of a sudden, this rock and roll fantasy turns into a nightmare.
Rock and roll and the legal quagmire, uh-huh. I can take you there. It's no fun.
They waged a bitter legal battle with their ex-manager.
To think that they would walk out on me and be sued for $57 million in damages. Please don't tell me that's the
way that it goes. Then they fought the tax man.
Well, after the Terry Knight lawsuits, after the depositions, and after all the red tape, then the IRS comes after me. And it's like, when will people stop attacking me?
It's really your worst dream from hell.
People have committed suicide for less. We're an American band.
We're an American band. Now, for the first time on television, the rise and fall and rebirth of an American band. Grand Funk Railroad, Behind the Music. Grand Funk Railroad barreled onto the late 60s rock scene like a runaway train. In seven unparalleled years, Mark Farner, Don Brewer, and Mel Shocker became the first American band to rack up 10 consecutive platinum albums.
When the Beatles broke up, Mark, Don, and Mel came on the scene in America. Sold out Shea Stadium faster than the Beatles, sold over 30 million records, and garage bands sprung up all across America because their music was accessible. I said, hey there, baby, do you want to make the scene?
Oh, well, come on over, baby. Step into my time machine. They came from the Rust Belt town of Flint, Michigan, to take on the world.
Living in Flint at that time in the early 70s, it was like a non-stop Grand Funk soundtrack. Are you ready? You can trust me all the way. No matter where you went, whether it was just driving down the street, whether it was going out to the park or to the lake, or just, you know, in the shopping mall, Grand Funk Railroad was blasting everywhere. When you grow up in Flint and you always feel like you're the underdog, you don't really see yourself as being much more than that person who's installing the doors, you know, on the Buick LeSabre. She's some kind of wonderful. She's
some kind of wonderful. Yes, she is. 17-year-old Don Brewer saw music as a way to escape the Flint assembly lines. In 1966, he was playing drums for the Jazz Masters, a popular local band. After a gig, Don was approached by 22-year-old Terry Knight, a former disc jockey with hopes of becoming a singer.
That was the direction I wanted to go, leaving radio, going into rock.
He hit us up and said, you know, I want to be a singer. He had the gift of gab. This guy could walk into a room, any place, find the right people to go to, and immediately go there and start talking.
Don joined Knight, and the Jazz Masters were renamed Terry Knight and the Pack. Next, 17-year-old guitarist Mark Farner was added to the group.
They needed a bass player, so I turned from guitar player into instant bass player.
Mark Farner impressed me as being total energy, limitless energy. A young, vibrant personality, played guitar well, played bass well, always eager to learn and always eager to perform.
Terry Knight and the Pack scored a hit record on the Lucky 7 label in the summer of 66.
Keep as your diamonds.
That was our first real experience at being somebody. First we charted in Flint, then we charted in Detroit.
I, Who Have Nothing, peaked at number 46 on the Billboard singles chart. But it was a big enough hit to earn them a national TV spot on Where the Action Is.
He can buy you the world.
The band never had another hit, and in 67, Knight left to pursue a solo career.
Terry Knight decided he was going to go off on his own. He wanted to be more of a cabaret singer. So he left, and that's when we pushed Mark out front as the frontman of the Pack.
Mark Farner became the new lead singer of the Fabulous Pack, and Don Brewer, Craig Frost, and Rod Lester rounded out the group. They knocked around Flint for a year, until a local management outfit promised them some gigs on the East Coast.
We get to Cape Cod, and management doesn't produce the gigs, and they've got us in a couple of little cabins out on Cape Cod in February, I think it was, you know, and it was cold, and these places weren't heated.
Out of nowhere, the worst snowstorm in the history of the world hit the East Coast.
We were melting down snow, boiling that, mixing it with oatmeal, you know, the management is nowhere in sight, they left us with no money, you know.
After suffering through two frozen weeks on Cape Cod, they came home to Flint, where Craig Frost and Rod Lester promptly quit the Fabulous Pack.
The two guys that were in the band that were married, their wives, when we got back, they threatened to divorce and they couldn't, you know, they had to quit the band.
Early in the spring of 69, Mark and Don were making plans for a new group. Don suggested they contact Terry Knight, who was now working for Capitol Records, promoting new artists.
I said, Donnie, this guy, I don't trust him. He is a chameleon. He's a great con man, but I don't trust him. And Brewer says, well, at least we'd be a step away from Flint, Michigan.
Knight expressed interest in the idea of a power trio.
That got our minds working, you know, because what was happening now, 67, 68, Jimi Hendrix, Cream, Blue Cheer, the power trio thing was happening.
With Don on drums and Mark on guitar, they needed a bass player. Mark invited another Flint musician, bassist Mel Shocker, to complete their power trio.
He says, what do you think about a three-piece band, you know? Three-piece? You mean like Hendrix or Cream or something? I mean, big and some guts to it? And he went, yeah. I went, absolutely.
We started practicing and coming up with original stuff. We were taking the old Pack material and just really changing it, you know, from a four-piece kind of 60s feel to this new power trio kind of feel.
I knew in rehearsals that we had something. We all did.
When Mark, Don, and Mel were ready, Terry Knight flew in from New York to check out the new trio.
I was astounded. I heard something that was extremely different. I knew it was singular, unique, and I had to be part of it.
Knight agreed to manage the group, and they soon came up with a name.
Grandpa. Michigan Railway Line, the Grand Trunk Railroad.
It was the summer of 1969, the season of Woodstock and the great outdoor rock festivals. Grand Funk Railroad pulled out of Flint, headed for stardom. It took a bit of luck to get the train rolling.
We got the lucky break to do the Atlanta Pop Festival through our booking agent, Jeep Holland. We were having trouble getting gigs around the Michigan area because everybody there was going, oh, that's just the Pack. And Jeep got a call from this guy, said, hey, if you can get that new band of yours down here on opening day, I can get them on.
The Atlanta Pop Festival gave Grand Funk a chance to play on the same bill with major acts like Led Zeppelin and Janis Joplin. Mark, Don, and Mel took the stage in Atlanta on July 4th, 1969.
I looked out on an ocean of people, 185,000 people. I thought, I can't look out there. That's too far to look. You know, it was just, my guts were totally in a knot.
We're going, oh my God. I can't believe we're about to do this.
It was 12 noon, it was time to rock, and these boys from Flint, Michigan went on.
Are you ready? You can trust me all the way.
From the opening chords, Grand Funk Railroad rocked the huge festival crowd.
Chanting and going and rocking.
I ripped my shirt off. The audience went nuts. That was like, I learned that, hey, they like that bare-chested stuff, you know?
When Mark would take his shirt off, the women in the audience sometimes would take their shirts off. That was the response that I cued in on. Oh, wow, what's that in the front row? Woo! You know?
We left. They gave us a standing ovation, called us back for an encore.
I look at Brewer, and he's looking at me like, do you believe this, dude? You know, we are a garage band, man, from Flint, Michigan. We are 20 years old.
That 4th of July show was the coming out party for a group that would become known as the American Band.
Atlanta was definitely the turning point for Grand Funk Railroad, and the word of mouth of Grand Funk Railroad went across the country like wildfire.
Capitol Records wanted Grand Funk, but to get the band, Capitol had to make a deal with their manager, Terry Knight.
You have to remember that Grand Funk were not signed to Capitol Records. Grand Funk was signed to me.
Since Mark, Don, and Mel were already under contract to Knight, Capitol signed a deal with Knight for their services. It was a deal that would lead to bitter conflict over the next 3 years.
You know, you're 20, 21. All you want to do is play music. You're not really thinking about, you know, how much money's coming in. You're just having so much fun at that point. It's not until later on when you get home at the end of the tour and you realize, wait a second, I can't pay the rent, that something's wrong.
I was 20 years old, Don was 20 years old, Mel was 19.
You know, we looked at each other and went, wow, this is really big. Didn't realize it. We just put our nose to the grindstone and went to work.
Just 3 weeks after the Atlanta Pop Festival, Grand Funk released their first Capitol single. Time Machine went to number 48. By October, their debut album, On Time, cracked the top 30. Was a modest start for a band that would soon be dominating the charts. Grand Funk Railroad roared out of Flint, Michigan in the summer of 69 and caused the sensation at the Atlanta Pop Festival. Later that summer, they returned to Michigan as the opening act on a Led Zeppelin tour, set to kick off at Detroit's Olympic Stadium. Mark, Don, and Mel were cheered as local heroes.
I think we were stealing the thunder from the old Led Zeppelin boys.
Midway through their performance, the crowd began to pick up chairs and anything they could reach in adulation and response. It was overwhelming, an unbelievable response.
Peter Grant, Led Zeppelin's manager, is getting ticked. He's getting peeved because my band's not going to be able to follow him. That's, you know, I'm sure that's what he's thinking.
Peter Grant, man, is a huge guy.
Peter Grant was a 6'4", 280-pound ex-professional wrestler.
He came over to me and bent over me and said, you will take the group off the stage immediately. At the same time, he reached over with one arm, grabbed me by the neck and shirt, and lifted me completely off the ground to his eye level. Looking me directly into the eye, he said, I said, immediately.
And the power went off. What the heck's this?
Terry comes up on stage and he announces to the audience, you know, that Led Zeppelin's afraid to follow Grand Funk. You know, to the audience, boo, boo.
A riot ensued. They tore the place up inside and the concert wasn't continued.
At that point, we said, yeah, we blew Zeppelin off the stage. How about that?
Grand Funk was kicked off the Zeppelin tour, but it didn't matter. There was no stopping them now.
Record sales jumped from tens of thousands to hundreds of thousands, and then overnight, they found Grand Funk in possession of their first gold album, the Red Album, called Grand Funk.
By the end of January 1970, Grand Funk's second album had risen to number 11 on the charts, and they embarked on their first world tour as headliners. On several tour stops, overflow crowds of frustrated fans rioted when major venues sold out in record time.
When Grand Funk's tickets were no longer available on a sold-out show, fans didn't really care about that. They stormed the doors, they pushed windows in, they turned police cars over in the street.
They wanted to get in. We were the people's band. We were saying things with music and song. I wrote songs about the Vietnam War, people, let's stop the war. I wrote songs about crooked politicians and about the environment.
I think the reason that a lot of people who are from the working class, you know, related to Grand Funk's music is because, you know, we were the group of people that were sent over to Vietnam to kill and be killed. and for what reason. They didn't send the rich kid over from Yale into those jungles. They sent those kids from Flint, Michigan.
Our crowd was pissed. You know, they were really not satisfied with what we were given.
Tapping into that emotion, Mark Farner wrote a song that became a subtle anti-war anthem.
It was like a lick that just came off the top of my head. And that triggered me going into the other room and grabbing the lyrics that I'd written down at about 3:30 in the morning and sat it down in front of me. And it all came, started making sense. Everybody, listen to me. And through the time my ship, I'm your captain. I'm your captain. Though I'm feeling mighty sick.
Grand Funk's third album, Closer to Home, was released in June of 1970. A month later, it made the top 10.
Closer to Home is one of very few records that will be played for the rest of time, in my opinion.
Mark Thompson of the syndicated radio team, Mark and Brian, was in high school at the time.
I went and bought the album Closer to Home, first album I ever heard, and it was an anthem. I had the album for the turntable, I had the 8-track for the car, and I knew every word, every note.
I'm getting closer to my...
I remember when I was 17, 18 years old, the day I had to go down and sign up for the draft. I remember that song being on the radio, I'm Getting Closer to My Home. And I remember thinking, I hope that chorus just keeps going and it goes on forever. I just thought, this is my home, not Vietnam. This is my home.
In tune with the mood in the streets, Grand Funk was the people's band. By 1971, they had sold 10 million records in just over 2 years. Manager Terry Knight kept the Grand Funk publicity engine chugging along. He got Capitol Records to pay for a gigantic block-long billboard in Times Square.
No one had ever done anything like that before. This was a first.
My face was 120 feet tall, you know?
And I remember looking up and I went, oh my God. It was embarrassing.
Ooh, baby, when times are good.
Mark, Don, and Mel were big, and they were about to get bigger. On June 5th, 1971, tickets went on sale for a Grand Funk concert in New York's Shea Stadium. The only other band to have played Shea was the Beatles back in 65. Grand Funk's Shea Stadium concert sold out in 72 hours. It took the Beatles 7 weeks.
Anybody probably fantasizes of that moment where you could say bigger than the Beatles. And the fact that that actually happened with Grand Funk, that they were from Flint, that Flint could kick the Beatles' ass was really something.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
By the summer of 1971, just 2 years after they began as a power trio, Grand Funk Railroad had become one of the top live acts in rock and roll. Their sold-out concert in New York Shea Stadium was a mass demonstration of their growing star power. Peter Frampton and his band Humble Pie opened for Grand Funk at Shea Stadium.
It was an honor to be there. That's the way we felt. You know, the Beatles have been here, and now here we were.
You look round, and there was just this mass of faces, you know, and it was more people than I'd ever seen in one show in my life.
What's happening? Yeah.
We got 2 choppers to take us. We go in the big one.
Like the Beatles before them, Grand Funk flew in a helicopter to the stadium.
It was very quiet, very tense, very aware we were making history.
Flying over Shea Stadium, you could hear the crowd. It was like this tunnel of sound emanating up, you know, and you could hear it over top of the chopper.
The whole place was like just electrified, and I remember just goosebumps going, and more goosebumps, and these waves of emotion going, wow, look at that, check this out.
The place is rocking. Behind the stage, they've got this big lit-up spectacular signs, Mark, Don, and Mel welcome New York City or something like that.
There was no words exchanged. When I looked over at Mel, he was just like, can you believe this, Farner? I mean, it's like, we're the three guys from Flint, Michigan, the garage band, who's on stage now at Shea Stadium in front of 50,000 people.
We could see the entire stadium oscillating, the bleachers moving up and down. I heard rumors of how the structural engineers were called in and threatening to stop the concert.
There were serious fears that the stadium might actually cave in.
I remember seeing Hard Day's Night and how fans were treating the Beatles, and they're, you know, they're starting to treat us like this, and it's like, this is really a fantasy. This can't be happening.
It was a triumphant night for the boys from Flint, but Shea Stadium also marked the beginning of open hostility between Grand Funk and manager Terry Knight.
We knew that a lot of money was being generated by Grand Funk Railroad, but we knew, too, that by our bank account, we were seeing very little of it.
We were selling millions and millions of records, and success was really being sweet. We're not seeing the money.
Don and I went into Terry's room one day at the motel, and I was sick of $350 a week. And I just told him, I says, I want to know what's going on with this money. I need to know right this minute, dude. I'm going to get a piece of your butt. And he started, like, shaking, because I just wanted to kill him.
The tens, if not hundreds of thousands of dollars a week they were making was put into their bank account as a corporation. The $350 a week, or whatever they drew as a salary, was entirely up to them.
Income from concerts, records, and royalties went into a corporation named Grand Funk Enterprises Limited. Money from the corporation was invested in speculative oil and gas ventures with a company called White Shield.
We get statements from White Shield Oil and Gas. This well was dug over here, and, you know, because it was a dry well, you know, they won't produce.
We were innocent. We believed in people. When they tell you that they're going to get the job done, we absolutely believed in it.
But while hits like Footstomp and Music were marching up the charts, the ugly rift between the band and Terry Knight was widening. The bad blood came to a boil when Mark, Don, and Mel learned that Capitol's deal with Knight gave Terry 16% of the profits from Grand Funk's music.
And we went, 16%?
He had a 16% deal, and he's taking 10%, and we're getting 6 and dividing it among three guys.
The group seemed to consider that I was getting the lion's share. Well, it wasn't a lion's share by any stretch of the imagination. I'm the one who got them the record contract. I'm the one who put up the investments, and I'm the one who battled from day one to put them where they were.
In the spring of 72, the band fired Knight.
My first response was devastation. Here's a group I had fought for, I'd let blood for, I'd gone to war for. Was I finished? No, Terry Knight was not finished.
On March 26, Knight announced that he was suing Mark, Don, and Mel for $57 million for breach of their management contract.
They were in breach of contract, there's no question about it. Ironically, if they had waited 3 months, they would have been out of the contract.
8 months after Knight filed his lawsuit, Grand Funk performed an anti-drug benefit concert in New York's Madison Square Garden. Knight came to the Garden that night with a court order, intent on seizing the band's assets.
Terry Knight shows up in Madison Square Garden for rehearsal with his attorneys, with a couple of sheriffs, New York City sheriffs, and they're going to start taking our equipment off stage.
After the show, Knight confiscated the band's instruments and equipment.
I was owed a lot of money, and those instruments were worth a lot of money. It also served to give them a lesson that they weren't fooling with a fool.
I just blew it. You're not going to take my drums, you know. You aren't going to die. I stormed off stage, and then I lost it. That was like, how much deeper can this go?
As the legal battle wore on, Mark, Don, and Mel found themselves in a desperate position.
What's going to happen, they're telling us, is that they're going to keep you tied up in courts for years. And that's what we're looking at. We're effectively looking at the end for Grand Funk.
We couldn't have survived. That's what inspired the settlement out of court.
The band settled with Knight. Grand Funk got to keep their name, but Knight got the money and almost everything else.
In the end, Grand Funk gave all the money they had and all of their investments to me in payment for wrongfully walking out on a contract 3 months early. How stupid can you get?
Knight also kept the lucrative publishing rights to all the Grand Funk songs, which he had already published through his own company.
The media, as far as I can see, have always looked at Terry Knight as wearing the black hat. That's never bothered me. As long as I can wear the black hat to the bank every week, I don't feel bad about that at all.
Grand Funk had to start over. It would be the greatest challenge of their career.
We weren't going to make it unless we could come back with something that was bigger and better than ever.
The band went back to work, this time as a quartet. Keyboard player Craig Frost, an old friend from the Fabulous Pack days, was invited to join the group. In the fall of 72, they released their fifth top 10 album in a row titled Phoenix.
Coming back and doing the Phoenix album was raising up and, you know, saying, hey, no matter what happened before, we're still together, we're still brothers, we still make music, and we love each other.
We had one really good rock song on there, Rock and Roll Soul, and it really kind of saved us because it was a top 40 hit.
Yet while Rock and Roll Soul reached number 29, Grand Funk realized that the music business was changing. Rock fans and radio stations were embracing more polished pop rock sounds, and album-oriented radio formats were dying out. But Grand Funk had never made a top 10 single. To survive, they needed to revamp their sound. Pop hitmaker Todd Rundgren was hired to produce their next record.
Approach that we took to the project was that there was going to be a transformation of the band, not only in terms of their actual recordings, but their whole image. I think for the first time they started thinking in terms of writing singles, or writing songs that could have some commercial appeal, rather than writing songs that were performance vehicles.
Brewer emerged as a songwriter during the sessions and wrote a song about life on the road in a working band.
You get a limousine, you go to the airport, you know, you just write songs about what you do, you know. You're an American band. I get the chord progression going, and then the thought came back in my mind. We're an American band.
Yeah, there were four young Chiquitas in Omaha. That was a real thing, and each one was designated to take each member of the band and take care of us while we were in Omaha.
Four young Chiquitas in Omaha, waiting for the band to return from the show. Feeling good, feeling right, it's Saturday night. The hotel detective, he was on the side.
We're an American Band was released in advance of the album on July 2nd, 1973.
2 weeks later, while we're sort of wrapping up the record, the song has already cracked the top 10 in the charts. The song went number one before we were finished recording the record.
Having a number one single is just definitely a good feeling, but you know, having gone through what we went through prior to that was the best.
Mark, Don, and Mel had risen to the challenge.
This is the sweetest revenge that you could ever imagine, because Terry Knight had us down, the critics had us down, everybody had us pegged as being the biggest losing band in the world, and man, we are back and we got a hit.
After a long, bruising legal battle with their ex-manager, Grand Funk Railroad was nearly knocked off the track. But the band picked up steam in 1973 when We're an American Band became their first number one single.
Everybody gonna shine, shine, shine. Keep it shine.
Their next record with producer Todd Rundgren was another chart-topping success.
We were doing the second album, Shining On, but we didn't have anything as apparently hooky and commercial as We're an American Band. There was some nervousness about that. And so we figured we better cover ourselves, and so cover we did, literally.
Now that you feel, let's make a change now. Come on and baby, do
Grand Funk's cover of The Locomotion, a pop classic by Jerry Goffin and Carole King, also went to number one.
We just kind of slapped that together after the rest of the record was done, and lo and behold, it became the calling card for the follow-up album.
Mark, Don, and Mel were at the height of their musical powers, but their legal problems and rock and roll lifestyle had taken a toll on their personal lives.
My lifestyle was not conducive to a happy home and marriage. I was divorced in 1975. I wrote a song called Bad Time to Be in Love. The song was written in some real turmoil.
Mark's marriage broke up, but his song went to number four in the spring of 75. The single, Some Kind of Wonderful, went one notch higher, and All the Girls in the World Beware became Grand Funk's eighth consecutive top 10 album. It would also be their last. They had come through trial by fire to emerge as one of the best-selling acts in rock history, but the tight bonds within the band were becoming frayed.
There were some strains within the band that were starting to show. The Born to Die album was kind of an indication of what was in the future for Grand Funk Railroad.
The band's 1976 album, Born to Die, was their last on Capitol Records. You say that this is
the end. There were some songs in there where they were singing about each other and the love lost between them. You may not care
right now. We have drastically changed from 1969 to 1975. So we're starting to feel like, well, boy, man, maybe this is, you know, this isn't going to last forever. The band wasn't really harmonious anymore.
I think there was some musical difference, too. Mark was very much into political commentary and environmental issues, and I think Donnie was more into just wanting to be a party band.
It can be very heart-wrenching when you love both of these guys. They have two different opinions.
I gotta have quad stereo on mine or I ain't going.
The idea of going to a place that sold caskets and that whole film that we did for the Born to Die album was just promotional. We didn't have any plan on the band. It was almost like an omen, a bad omen, to have gotten into those coffins.
Neither Born to Die nor their next album, Good Singing, Good Playing, scored a hit. In the summer of 76, disco ruled the radio.
People were buying an ever more frivolous musical product. So it put them in a real bind. Certainly we weren't going to write disco music.
We could not bow our knee to the god of disco. Grand Funk doesn't disco.
You know, that was always our thing. Let's not kick a dead horse.
We've been out here for a long time. Let's give it a rest. Donnie said, I think we should quit. Okay. It was that simple.
After 7 years together, Grand Funk Railroad's ride to rock and roll glory was over.
We all wish that they had just hung in there and destroyed disco, you know, and not give in to the sort of cotton candy version of rhythm and blues, funk, etc. And it didn't happen. They just sort of went away. And it was sad when that happened.
When Grand Funk broke up, Mark, Don, and Mel pursued separate musical and personal interests. But 14 years after calling it quits, the trio found themselves fighting yet another battle together. This time, the enemy was the Internal Revenue Service. Trouble began with a tax shelter the band set up in 1976.
Grand Funk Railroad put $100,000 in a coal venture that was disallowed. But the IRS never told us that they were going to disallow it and assess a tax until 14 years later, 1990. And I said, wait a minute. Time out. Isn't there a statute of limitations here?
With interest and penalties, the back taxes the IRS now sought to collect had mushroomed into a shocking total.
My portion, you know, was $33,333, you know, one-third. In 1990, when they assessed the tax and the penalties and interest, my portion was over $250,000.
The IRS is going to come in and take everything. They can come in and they can take your house. They can put this tax bill over onto your family. They can put it onto your wife.
It was an ongoing nightmare for all of them.
The power that they have is it can be devastating.
When the IRS says, we're selling your house and your property and everything in it, and you have to go into a Chapter 11 to stop the sale of everything that you've worked for all your life, you're this far from divorce, from suicide, a lot of things cross your mind.
Mark had remarried in 1978, and the stress of the tax fight strained the bonds of his new marriage.
The IRS has the ability to put quite the squeeze on your life. It's been difficult at times for us to maintain our focus as a family.
It almost busted our marriage wide open. But through our faith and our belief that somehow God is going to deliver us from the hands of our enemy, that's what's kept us together.
Thank God for grace, because that is what has sustained us.
Don and Mel eventually settled with the IRS, but Mark Farner continues to fight.
Well, after the Terry Knight lawsuits, after the depositions, and after all the red tape, then the IRS comes after me, and it's like, when will people stop attacking me?
By 1995, 26 years and 40 million records after they first rocked the world, Mark Farner, Don Brewer, and Mel Shocker had moved on with their lives. They had battled their former manager, disco music, and the tax man, and had come through the turmoil intact.
I don't know what these three guys did to deserve some of the stuff that came their way, but they survived it beautifully. They came through on the other side, and they're all healthy, and they lead very happy lives. Don is a whole different person when he's on stage. I felt that he should be playing drums. I felt it was a waste of talent that he wasn't.
I knew that there was a hole in Mel's life. He was still earning good money doing what he was doing, which was investing and etc. But there was a hole in his life. His brothers were missing.
I believe that God has sustained them for this purpose, because they really have the ability to do something that very few men have the ability to do, and they do it well.
But they hadn't done it for a very long time. So in 1996, Mark, Don, and Mel held a secret reunion at a secluded hunting lodge to see if Grand Funk Railroad could get back on track.
Brewer came in a rent-a-car and pulls up. And I went up and I hugged him, and it was like breaking the ice. And he sat down, he says, well, I'm kind of rusty. He says, I feel like the chops are definitely back there somewhere, and it'll probably take us 6 or 8 months before we can really get ready to play music.
Although the guys didn't know it, they had an audience.
I walked right into them playing Closer to Home. For the first time in many years, I heard them live again. And I stood there and held my breath. I couldn't believe it. It was mesmerizing. And they stopped in the middle of the song. And I heard them laughing. And I had not heard them laughing together in so many years. And it was like coming home.
After the second day, it was like Donnie says, I think we're there. I think this is it.
He said, we can do a show right now, tonight. I'm blown away. I am amazed.
We're back. We're here. Come with us.
Are you ready? You can trust me all the way.
The American band reemerged in 1996, and the response was overwhelming.
And the world will know it's right.
I was totally blown away by the cult following that this band has. They performed to sold-out crowds and sold-out venues all over the country, and that just doesn't happen with reunion bands.
People have an appreciation for what's good. If it's good at one point, it will always be good.
Secure in the knowledge there was still an audience for Grand Funk, they launched an ambitious 85-city tour in 1998. It was no oldies act. Grand Funk was still a formidable power trio.
We've been lost now, days uncounted.
This band is better now than they've ever been.
To see them live, it's almost like a religious experience.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
The people love this band. It's not concocted by some record company. It's not choreographed by image consultants. This is a people's band, a band that just wants to rock and roll, hard-driving, industrial rock and roll that relates to the average hard-working American.
They still enjoy doing it. I think that they're almost better than they were then.
We're a little older, but we're kids, you know? And we're having a great time.
All your Chiquitas in Omaha, waiting for the band to return from the show.
I
really never thought that it would be there again, and to have it again is just, I'm getting chills right now talking about it.
Once you get on stage, that's your baby, and you love your baby, and it's all home. It's home free. From that point on, it's a breeze.
This band, Grand Funk, represents the fact that rock and roll truly is the people's music, and that it is open to anyone, and I mean anyone, who can come out of their garage and end up in Shea Stadium. There's a road in Flint, and it goes underneath an overpass, and the overpass is the Grand Trunk Railroad overpass. And someone 25, 30 years ago changed it to Grand Funk Railroad and put Mark, Don, and Mel. Nobody has touched that graffiti in 25 years. It's still there, and every time you drive under it, you remember that this is the one train that got out of Flint.
We're an American band, yo! Why can't I get a win?
Maybe it's your natural curiosity. Maybe you're just worried about them. After all, they don't call, they don't write. Where are they now? We've caught up with your favorite rock stars, and we're making them answer that very question. Catch VH1's Where Are They Now Marathon, Tuesday night, starting at 7, 6 Central, only on VH1.